Okay, we were talking during break about situations where people weren't really sincere about changing. And what we're talking about tonight, we're talking about the process of change. We're going to finish the lesson on change, the process of change. Then we're going to be taking a look at counseling goals. One of the most difficult things to change about a person is a homosexual lifestyle. Now, is that to say that change is not possible? All changes are possible. It's difficult. And the reason why it's difficult, as is any other particular lifestyle, is because the desire to remain in that lifestyle is so strong. And when a person begins to justify, a person justifies their actions, their behavior, then there is little or no possibility of change. And so to go back and to pick up what we said right before we went on break, one way to determine if a person is resistant to change is if they just continuously excuse themselves, or if they say yes, but, and they continuously say it won't work. Truth of the matter is they don't really want it to work. We have to also give the counselee an opportunity to work through their feelings. In other words, you may not see the changes that you desire to see. And that, too, is something you have to take a look at. You have to take a look at yourself. And you're going to have to determine, is this something you expect? Is this something that's meeting your need to see a particular change? Or do you look for sincere changes, however small it may be, in the person? Another thing that we need to take a look at before we come to the conclusion that a person doesn't want to change, as I said, is look at your own expectations. Unrealistic expectations begin when you want a person to progress according to your own need for results. You may become tempted to blame the client or the counselee for not progressing more quickly, and you may doubt they're sincere because in your mind they may not be moving as fast as you think they should. Now, just as you may have an unrealistic expectation of a counselee, the counselee may have an unrealistic expectation of you. They may be expecting, because of your training, because of your faith, your knowledge, your experience, they may be expecting you to have all the answers. They may be expecting you to be the expert, and that may be unrealistic. Now, I'm not a proponent of long-term counseling. I say that in lieu of long-term counseling, the person ought to be getting into some type of a discipleship program. Or they ought to be getting into a situation where they're accountable, be held accountable for their actions, to get involved in some type of, well, just Bible classes, Bible study classes. But after a significant period of time, that if you see that a person doesn't seem to be making any progress, you may just simply gently confront the counselee. You might say something like this: we've been talking for a long time now, and ask them, do you think we're making any progress? And if they can verbalize progress is being made, then that might be reason to continue on. It's important that the counselor also provide a climate for change. Sometimes the desire to change is there, but the person just doesn't know what to do or how to do it. So what can we do? What can we do to help them? What kind of climate can we create? Well, one thing is, and this is a climate that is conducive for change, is to express confidence in him. You express confidence in the individual and say that I'm confident. I really believe that you can change. I really believe that you have some strengths here. Point out the strengths that you've observed in the counselee. Remind him of maybe some of the strengths that he's forgotten about. Remember, the counselee has a right to his own choices. Many life-changing lessons are only learned through our suffering the consequences of a mistake or a sin. What are we talking about here? We're talking about a climate. We're talking about creating a climate. We're talking about the counselor creating a climate that's conducive for change. And that climate might simply be to come to the realization to say, you have the power to choose. I can insist, I can encourage, but the bottom line is you're the one who's going to have to make the choice. You're going to have to determine whether you're going to turn it around or not. It's just like you were talking about during the break, about finally coming to the place and saying to this individual, truth of the matter is, you really enjoy this lifestyle, you really don't want to change, and if that be the case, then we're just kind of wasting each other's time. And then more or less came to that conclusion. I'm recalling a counseling session I had many years ago. Several years ago, 8-10 years ago. And this was counseling an elder. This was a spiritual leader in the church, marital counseling. And we had had several sessions. And there was not any apparent movement on the part of the elder himself. That it seemed like the wife was making more of an effort come to some resolutions of the problem than he. And I came to the realization, you know, that after a while, after giving him ample opportunity and for creating a climate to discuss some of the potential problems there, I came to the conclusion that he didn't really want it to work. He didn't really care for it to work. And when I confronted that, he got angry at me and was more or less turning that on me to make it look like that I was the one who was aborting the counseling process so that he could have somebody to blame. But see, the truth of the matter is that he didn't want reconciliation. He did not want the marriage to be restored. That marriage ended up in a divorce. And that's been 8 or 10 years ago. And the marriage is still dissolved. Neither one is remarried. But my point here is that it took a while for me to get to the place to confront this individual and to say, I don't really believe that you're sincere about really wanting to make this thing work. Another way of creating a climate, providing a climate for change, is to recognize that in the process of counseling, there's always going to be almost like the necessity of plateaus. When you first get involved in counseling, maybe some things come to light, and there may be a dramatic upswing in the beginning. It may look like that things are really happening quickly. But after a while, it's almost like you hit a stagnation. And really what it may be is just simply be a leveling off time. And there's a reason for this. It might simply be the fact that this person going through a period of time of adjusting to what they've learned. In other words, you don't necessarily expect dramatic results every time that you come together. Dr. Worthington is a Christian counselor that I have a book that he wrote on marriage counseling, Christian marriage counseling. But I took some of his ideas from his marriage counseling to apply it to counseling in general. And what I want to introduce here is that he proposes that there are three steps of change. Three steps of change. This is a good test question. Three steps. Step number one, awareness. simply becoming aware of the problem. If you're not aware of a problem, there's nothing to change. No motivation to change. You become aware of the problem. Number two is that you seek to break old patterns. And the third step is to establish new patterns. Well, isn't that what we talked about a while ago? Was that what we were talking about in putting off and putting on? It's very obvious that you're going to need to be aware. Then the second step would be putting off. Third step would be putting on. Jay Adams says dehabituation, meaning breaking old habits. Rehabituation, establishing new habits. Two structures must be changed. There's the cognitive structure that has to do with the way we think. And then there is the environmental. That's the circumstances surrounding our lives. What tools does the counselor have to accomplish the task of affecting cognitive and environmental structures? Basically, only what can be done in the counseling session. Now, you can have an influence, and you should have an influence that goes beyond the counseling, but the truth of the matter is that a counselor has very limited contact with the counselee. May not be over 1 hour a week. You might have continued influence through assignments and so forth. But wouldn't this be one of the advantages of Christian counseling, especially in a church setting, is where the counselor perhaps is a minister or a staff member who would be in a covenant relationship with the person that you're counseling? You would have much more of an opportunity, would you not, to have input into their lives. It would be a greater possibility of accountability. So that would be a definite advantage of having counseling in a church setting, wouldn't it? Okay? Rarely does something change directly from one stable position to another stable position. There's a time of breaking old patterns. As they break, the client experiences distress and discomfort. You see, when you're in a process of change, it's not comfortable, is it? And, you know, as old patterns break, you need to prepare the client for the possibility of getting a little discouraged, a little resistant. But as the old patterns break, you must help build new patterns. Let's move right on into goals of counseling. This is really the subject of our second hour tonight. We were just completing our first session. And what have we been talking about for the past hour? What have we been in the sense of talking about?
Motivation.
Change. Yeah, which of course we introduced motivation for change. Okay. And what do we say that change was a primary goal, right?
Right.
A primary goal. Right. We also introduced the fact that spiritual maturity is a goal. All right. Let's take a little closer look at the goals of counseling. The secular sector, the secular world, embraces the fact that your happiness is the ultimate goal of life. Your happiness. Now I'm going to ask you a loaded question here. Should happiness be the goal of Christian counseling? Should happiness be the goal of Christian counseling?
Well, it seemed to me like it would be one of the results. Because if we truly had success, and we say we get the alcoholic truly set free, then that's going to bring on a lot of happiness for a lot of people.
Okay, so we're actually saying probably needs to be maybe a distinction between joy and happiness, or contentment. It's been said that happiness depends upon happenings. If something happens that excites me, I may be happy.
Mm-hmm.
if somebody gives me a new tie or a new suit or someone gives me a new car, that happening may make me happy.
But somebody stole it.
it would be
sad. So you talk about emotions.
But
right?
the joy of the Lord should not depend upon circumstances, right? The joy of the Lord should not depend upon happenings.
We should say like love, but joy should be a fact.
Joy should be an abiding state, should it not?
Really?
Right. Joy should be the result of a relationship with Him. Joy is an aspect of the kingdom of God, right? Joy, peace, joy, happiness in the Holy Ghost.
I've learned how to abound or to be at peace.
Right, right. So it was not dependent upon, it wasn't dependent upon what was happening.
Certain things.
The three Hebrew children may not have been happy to have been in the fiery furnace, but they could have had the joy of the Lord.
Oh, I'm sure they did. They were in there dancing.
Yep. Amen. Okay.
Paul and Silas was in the prison scene, so.
Yeah, okay. So, you know, our question is, what is the client ultimately looking for in counseling? Universal response is, I want to feel good, or I want to be happy. There's nothing wrong in wanting to be happy. I think I've made this statement, I said I've been happy and I've been sad, and it feels a whole lot better to be happy than it is to be sad. I want to be happy, but the truth is, now here's the point, the truth is, I will never be happy if I am concerned primarily with becoming happy. I will not be happy if my primary concern is becoming happy. I think that a corollary here that applies to another situation that would be the same principle. God gives us the power to get wealth. I believe that prosperity is a blessing of the Lord. I don't believe that God's people should make that their priority. In other words, your goal should not be to get rich. Your goal is to please the Lord. Your goal is to be obedient to Him. Your goal is to do the will of God. See, it's just like Solomon. Solomon didn't ask for riches, did he not? He did not ask for long life. He asked for wisdom. But because he asked for the right thing, because he asked for wisdom, then he had riches added to him. He had long life. What did Solomon teach in the book of Proverbs? He says that by keeping the commandments of the Lord, that he would, what, riches are in her right hand and length of days in her left hand. So that is a, what, the byproduct of seeking the wisdom of God, seeking the face of God. So our primary goal is to please the Lord.
As the other scripture says, you know, in the New Testament, to seek ye first the kingdom of God and all these other things we added to.
Right. So where the secular world would say, you know, happiness is the goal, our goal is to please the Lord. Our goal is to be obedient to Him. And we believe that as a result of that, that's when peace and contentment is going to come. It's just like a person who places their happiness or their significance in what somebody else thinks about them. Well, guess what? You have very little, if any, control over what somebody thinks about you. You may behave yourself in a way that might lead other people not to think very well of you or speak very well of you. That's the only thing you have control over is what you do yourself. You have no control over how they respond to it. You have no control over how they perceive it. You have no control over none whatsoever whether they accept you or not. So my happiness should not depend on what somebody else does or how someone else responds. My happiness depends on who I am in Christ. My happiness depends on the significance I obtain from Him. My significance should not depend upon whether I'm a success according to the way the world measures success. It should depend upon whether the Lord considers me.
So when a counselor, and a counselor role, the role would seem to be almost redefining in the counselee's mind what happiness is, or giving a more focused definition of what
Absolutely.
Happiness is.
Absolutely.
You know, say one of the Christian sayings I like, if you can't steal your joy, you can't keep your goods.
Yeah, that's right. He's not going to steal your, if he can't steal your joy, he can't keep
anything stolen from you, or because he's always stole something to try to get your joy.
Well, it's just like, the scripture says, though the vine languish, you know, and there be no cattle in the stall, and there be no fruit on the tree,
how about it?
Yet I will rejoice, mm-hmm. See. And yes, that would be part of the role. That would be a significant role of the counselor, is to help a person to keep everything in proper focus, to keep everything with a proper perception, and to say to them, well, now you say this is important for your happiness. This is important for your sanity, for your soundness of mind. How important is this? You may say to them, well, what is the worst that can happen? You know, you just get all distressed because of certain circumstances, and you just have to simply point out, well, what is the worst thing that can happen? Well, what if that did happen? See? And so, yes, it would be a matter of redefining, be the matter of keeping the proper focus. Okay, so there's nothing wrong with wanting to be happy, but my overriding goal must be in every circumstance to respond biblically, to put the Lord first, to seek to behave as He would want me to. I must consciously and firmly, by an act of my will, reject the goal of becoming happy and adopt the goal of becoming more like the Lord. And the result will be happiness for me as I learn to dwell at God's right hand in fellowship. The basic reason for a person to want to solve his personal problem should be that he wants to enter into a deeper relationship with God and to more effectively please Him through worship and service. Now, are you going to be able to give that kind of counsel to somebody that's a heathen? No. But what are we? We're Christian counselors. We're being trained as Christian counselors. We're dealing with people that are either believers or they're at least, they recognize their need for the Lord. Of course, if they're not a believer, then it becomes a field for evangelism, doesn't it?
Seems to me like as a Christian counselor, would run in most commonly you would run into carnal Christians. That would be that's the whole root of their problem.
Yeah, and you know, and that's not to say that there would be situations. I would say that every person, regardless of their spiritual maturity, will no doubt have some situation in their life that there might be a need for them to be able to confide in someone that would at least be their equal or, you know, on their level. In other words, I think the bishop just says, you know, that you don't confess downward. You don't necessarily confess outward. You confess up, right? And I would say this. I would say that there would probably be situations where bishop, in fact, I know, of situations where men of high stature spiritually have had need for spiritual counsel.
Oh, yeah. Sure.
You know, but you're right, as a general rule, that most of the counseling problems that you deal with are let's use this terminology, immature. And that's not discrediting unless that person should be mature. See, you expect immature behavior from a babe, right? You don't expect your babies to act mature.
Right.
But you would expect mature behavior out of those who are supposed to be mature. Paul said when you have need to be a teacher, you have the need that others teach you what is what? The first principles. He said another place, he said, you're yet carnal because there are divisions among you, misunderstandings.
Well, that's one thing that work. What I've run into, and most of the time I've had to call in to talk to people, is warring after the flesh. Mm-hmm. They just absolutely going to not see themselves as dead. They're going to war after the flesh.
Okay, this is a little bit of review here. Also, when we talk about the composition of man, the makeup of man, psychoanalysis says the three states of man, the three parts of man are the id, the ego, the superego. Might be a good test question. The id relates to the basic nature, the animal instincts. All right, the ego is the mediator between the superego and the id. And the superego is like the conscious, or it's like this governing force. And what psychoanalysis says is that difficulties and emotional problems, psychological problems, arise when there is a conflict between the superego and the id. All right? The Bible says that the composition of man is what? Spirit, soul, and body. And as a general rule, where does your conflict come in? Or when do you basically have problems? Is when there is a conflict. Okay, it's usually in the realm of the soul. That's where your emotional problems, that's where your psychological problems basically are. But when are there problems? Is when there is a conflict between the spirit and the flesh, right? The conflict between the flesh and the spirit, okay? So we could say that maybe the problems, most of the problems are due to a state of immaturity. Now using that terminology, what then would become a goal for counseling? We're talking about goals. What then would become a goal for counseling? A specific goal.
I would like to get people to try to lead them into more spiritual maturity.
Okay.
Show them what their errors, where they're going wrong scripturally.
Yeah, and so when we're saying that perhaps a problem arises out of a state of immaturity, then a goal for counseling would be what? To help to bring them into
maturity.
Spiritual maturity. Okay? I want to introduce here the concept, and this is, let's see whose terminology this. I think, again, this may be Jay Adams. He says that there are two aspects of goals, and that is one is moving over and the other is moving up. We can liken this to horizontal relationships, vertical relationships, right? Horizontal relationship has to do with our relationship with man, our fellow man. Vertical has to do with our relationship with God. But here's what he identifies moving over as being. It is a change of behavior. That's a horizontal move, a change of behavior. But then there is an inward change. See, it's just like a while ago we were talking about when is a liar not a liar? Not necessarily when he's not lying. Because he may just simply not be lying because of circumstances, may be the safe thing to do.
Be on his best behavior.
Might be on his best behavior. It's just a matter of time before he lies. In other words, if a liar still has a spirit of lying, he may not be lying, but just as soon as the first opportunity comes along, he's going to lie. Okay, so changing behavior should not be our ultimate goal, but to change the inward man, to change attitudes, to change the hidden man of the heart. Attitudes must change. So changing behavior is likened to moving over. Attitude changes is moving up. Now, it's important for us to come to the conclusion of that which we're seeking to change if we're going to develop a proper counseling strategy. Are we trying to change the way a client feels? Are we just simply trying to eliminate his symptoms? Behaviors say the symptoms represent the total problem. You eliminate the symptoms and you eliminate the problem. But is that really what we're talking about as being the focus of Christian counseling? No. We're not seeking to remove the outward symptoms. We're seeking to change the heart. Okay? For the secularist, the goal is to help the client feel good, whatever it takes to make him feel good. The Bible said there is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. All right? So what are we to change? How a person thinks? Yes. I believe that's where it starts. I believe that's primarily, I think that is probably the primary goal, is to change the way a person thinks. Transformation depends on renewing minds. Be transformed by what?
Mm-hmm.
Renewing of your mind. Not our feelings, not our behavior, not our circumstances, but renewing our mind. Right behavior without right thinking produces a labored, pressured, effortful brand of Christian obedience. It's just like a father told a kid one day, said, sit down. And he said, I may be sitting down on the outside, but I'm standing up on the inside. Okay. The Bible says that the willing and the obedient shall eat the good of the land. You can be obedient outwardly without having a willingness on the inside. Okay. Let's look at the three primary goals of counseling in the counseling process. Primary goals. Now, we have specific goals. We have general goals and we have specific goals. For example, we may have the specific goal of helping a person to overcome fear. We may have the specific goal of helping a person or helping a married couple communicate. You may have the specific goal of helping the person to acquire certain skills. You may have the specific goal of giving support or helping a person to have self-understanding. But we have three primary goals, underlying goals of counseling that will help us toward the specific. Number one, the first goal. You have to identify the problem. Now, this is part of the counseling process also. Help the counselee to identify the problem. You see, the problem isn't always so obvious. When a person comes to me, I will usually say something like this. Well, first of all, I'll have them to fill out an intake, and I will ask specifically, what is it that brings you to counseling at this particular time? See, there has to be something that has motivated them to take that step. There had to be some precipitating factor involved, or perhaps some event, or some emotion that they're dealing with that has become so overwhelming that they seek for help. So you ask them, what brings you to counseling at this particular time? And then, of course, on the intake, you ask such things as, what are some of the issues that you would like to talk about? What are some of the issues that you would like to discuss in counseling? Well, the truth of the matter is, what a person verbalizes may not be the real issues for two reasons. Number one is, they may know what the real issue is, but they're not ready to talk about it. So they may just give some surface things, and which you have to finally get around to breaking through those barriers and finding out what the real problem is. Another thing is, they may not know. They may not really know what the issue is. they may be describing a certain set of circumstances. They may be saying, well, this is what happened, and this is the result of what happened, and this is the way I feel about it, but they themselves may not know. So your first goal is to seek to identify the problem. See, what may be totally obvious to you may not be obvious at all to the person you're trying to help. What may be obvious to him may not at all be clear to his wife or his girlfriend. Quite often we tend to magnify the faults of others and minimize our own. When a problem occurs, we tend to see ourselves in a different light than others do. See, your significant other, which could be a wife or a girlfriend, they may see a problem and think something is a problem. You don't recognize it as being a problem. I'm trying to think of, where was this? I'm trying to remember an example I had read somewhere where this person was convinced that a certain situation existed in the church. He got mad and went down the street and found out, you know, he was in conflict down there, and he was so convinced he was right. And until, I can't even remember the detail, but you know, the point is that other people may see things that you don't see. So you may not really be aware of what's actually taking place. All right, the second goal. Second goal of counseling is to analyze the available options and the consequences of accepting or rejecting each one. The first was to identify the problem. You may not identify the problem. You may not even identify the problem in the first session. It may take 2 or 3 sessions to really to identify the problem. But then when you find out what the real issue is, or issues, then you analyze the available options and you take a look at the consequences of accepting and rejecting each of them. Here you want to explore the available courses of action. You have to confront the counselee with the consequences of his or her action, as hard as it may be to face them. The past ceases to be important. The future is everything, and the present decides what the future will be. When we refuse to recognize the consequences, right or wrong, we live with the results of poor choices. All right, the third goal. You then help the counselee to discover and choose the will of God for his life. You identify the problem. You take a look at the available options. You discuss the consequences of accepting and rejecting those options. Then it's going to be left up to the counselee to make a proper choice. So it becomes a counselor's responsibility to help them in making the proper choices. As you analyze the consequences of the options, you then have to bring the one you're helping to a place of confrontation with the will of God. Obviously, it cannot be the will of God for a person to continue in any sinful relationship or situation. To right or wrong requires positive action, which means breaking habits that have become comfortable and perhaps enjoyable. When a counselee knows what is right but lacks the courage to take the first step toward the will of God, then you're going to have to use encouragement, love, and reinforcement without condemnation. That's a very real possibility. When a person is brought to they're brought to the decision point, that when you have discovered the problem, you've analyzed the options and the consequences of accepting or rejecting those options, and then bring that person to the place of accepting what you believe the will of God is based on what? The Word of God. It may not be an easy thing. You say, well, you know, you don't have any choice. That may be true. But a person may need encouragement. They need for you to help them to break these habits. Habits are developed over a period of time. Sometimes it may just take plain deliverance, right? It may take the divine intervention of God, the power of God.
I seen a case one time there where a woman thought her husband was wrong. and she was blaming him for everything. When he went to a counselor, he found out right away that she was the person that was wrong, and he confronted her with it, and that changed everything when she found out, hey, I'm the problem. Mm-hmm. And she had thought it was him all the time.
So apparently she was sincere, wasn't she?
Oh, yeah.
You know, so what, you pinpoint the problem, and then you bring up the options, then you bring a person to a place and have to make a decision.
He had to show her where she was wrong, but when he did, why she accepted it.
Right. And see, and here's another thing, here's another very important thing, is if that counselor had jumped, he may have observed, he may have analyzed that situation immediately, okay?
Yes, he did.
But he would never have had the result. He would not have had the same result had he jumped in and made that observation immediately. See, sometimes you have to help a person to come to grips with it, and you know, she wouldn't accept it if he'd have just made the statement saying, "Well, you know, you're just absolutely wrong."
In this case, he hit her hard and heavy, and she to this day don't like him, but he solved her problem.
Well, I guess it's one of the downsides of counseling, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, he didn't pull no punches with it.
It's a shame. It's a shame that after that she realized, you know, where the blame was, that she didn't come around to at least give him the proper respect.
Well, I think she had to be shocked out of it, kind of. Yeah. I don't think you could have eased her along. I think she had to really be hit with it. And he did anyway. It worked.
And that brings up another point, and that is that you have to deal with every situation individually. You know, you may deal with one person one way, and you deal with another person another way.
Absolutely.
One person may need to be confronted. I mean, they may need to be confronted hard and heavy. Another person that is fragile, you may destroy them with confrontation. That person may need to be built up. They need to be directed and guided, and you know, and then at some point in time, maybe confrontation would be necessary. Okay, so we talked about three general goals in counseling, which helps to give direction and structure for the counseling. And again, we can have specific goals that we work toward. Let me give you an example from marriage counseling. Here could be the way you break down some goals. The counselor may have certain preset goals. The counselee may come to counseling with certain goals, preconceived notions or ideas, and then, of course, it becomes the responsibility of the counselor to come up with what you believe to be mutually acceptable goals.
Can I ask this question here? Invades my mind is that when it's counseling and you're going to schedule counseling, like a woman and her husband comes and it's his problem, or she thinks it's his problem, or it's a child, is it important that are you able to deal with it successfully when she is bringing him, say, and he's not really wanting to come to counseling, or a child, you're bringing a 14-year-old, and that's the last thing in the world he wants to be is sitting before a counselor. He don't want that, but his parents are making him come.
Well, ultimately, you're not going to be very effective, but maybe initially, say even a husband that comes reluctantly, it's going to become your responsibility to help break through, you know, and to establish rapport. One of the things I find in counseling, especially when you have a husband and wife involved, is that you have to seek to balance it out. Maybe one time, one instance, you'll be more or less siding in with a husband, and then you'll switch over and you'll side in with a wife to keep it to sound like a two ganging up on one. You know, and then you establish a relationship, establish rapport, and you're able to hopefully to observe, you know, what is actually going on. So a person may reluctantly agree to come to counseling initially, and then it's going to be one of the goals of counseling is to establish that type of relationship and rapport that can help to draw out of them whatever the problem may be. And now, concerning a child, they could definitely be resistant to coming to counseling. And if they absolutely refuse to cooperate, you're not going to be able to open up your brain and pour all this information in. You're going to have to, again, there, you're going to have some way, somehow, you're going to have to be able to establish a level of trust. And what I would seek to do in a situation like that would be to, say if a parent brought a child in, and I would listen to the parent, and I would then probably ask the parent if they would step out. Then you would seek to establish a relationship with the child and even get their point of view, see, what their perspective is on it. And that becomes one of your goals of counseling, is to establish a relationship that you can draw out what needs to be drawn out. Okay, so we have specific goals, and the goals of counseling should be, in fact, to be effective, they have to be specific. And if there are differing goals between the counselor and the counselee, you have to resolve that discrepancy. Okay, in marriage counseling, for example, a counselor's goal could be the following. It could be to identify and understand the specific issues that are creating the marital problem. Counselor goal might be to teach the couple how to communicate constructively. Counselor goal could be to teach problem solving and decision making techniques. The counselor's goal could be to help them to express their frustration, disappointments, and desires for the future. The counselor's goal, I'm going to give you these notes here so you don't have to write all of it down. The counselor's goal might be to keep the husband and wife together. His goal may be to instill hope. It may be to teach the couple how to build a marriage based on biblical principles. Okay? The counselee's goals could include what or how does each partner experience a relationship? What does each yearn for? What would they like to see accomplished? What would they like to see change? What can be done? What is each willing to do now? All right, let me give you an example. A wife complains that her husband has been unfaithful, but the husband wants the freedom to have occasional sexual contact during business trips. The counselor is faced with a goal conflict. If the counselee goal conflicts, if they persist even after continued discussion, then the counselor would have to consider, whether they're going to withdraw from the counseling and refer them to someone else. Now, here's where the conflict is. That may be this guy's goal. He may want to continue doing what he's doing. But if that's in conflict with biblical principles, the counselor cannot be in agreement with that. I mean, the secular counselor might say, well, if that's what's agreeable between you and your wife, if that'll enhance you and all of this, fine. But that would represent a real conflict with a person who's seeking to be biblical. All right, let me just give you in closing here characteristics of goals. Looks like I only have two characteristics. I don't know if I lost the rest of them here, didn't write them down or what. I'll just give you the two I've got, okay? And if they're not on the study guide, don't worry about it. Goals should be positive. Your realistic yet optimistic adherence to goals can give the counselee a vision. Counseling should be both growth-oriented and problem-solving. The goal of problem-solving is to help people solve their problems so they can return to their normal lives. Goals would include to help decrease conflict and to increase communication. See, this is comparing the negative with the positive. You can say, well, my goal here is to decrease, but again, it's to increase, right? Your goal may be to put off, but it also is to what? Put on. The goal may be to clean out the house, but the goal should be what? To fill it up, right? The goal may be to break old habits, but on the positive side, it ought to be what? To establish new habits. Okay. So it's not just a matter of decreasing conflict, but then on a positive note, to teach how to increase communication. Instead of just having the goal of decreasing power struggles, you'd have the goal of increasing intimacy. Not just decreasing blame and unforgiveness, but to increase faith. And then the second characteristic I have here is that goals should be realistic. I know I've got some more here because I'm not going to stop right in the middle of this sentence here. Let's see what. But you know what? I don't have it. And I can't hold you responsible for that. So we'll just say at this point in time, goals should be positive and they should be realistic. If you have unrealistic goals, first of all, if the counselee doesn't buy into it, they're not going to have confidence in you, are they? Then the second thing is, what happens if you don't reach an unrealistic goal? Get frustrated. It's anxiety producing, right? Okay, well, that's our lessons on goals and the specific goal of change. Next week, we're going to present, as I said, I'm going to give you, this will be the final lesson for this course. I'm going to give you a class on a model, a good model, a structured model for following counseling. And then if we have some time, if we want to do so, we might go over some of our review questions, then we'll have a test the second hour. Good evening.